done it for so long that you had all that capability to work with?
Yes, it wasn't strategically planned. But I'm so sorry. But I was also coming from a marketing background. So the reason why I started cooking was because I was creating a strategy for one of my brands, and I came across a blogger, and it sparked my interest immediately. Because I said, I've never seen this in Ghana before. Who is a blogger? Like, who is a food blogger? And then I started, you know, just going into this deep hole of finding what food bloggers do. So I didn't plan to become a food blogger when I started. I didn't plan to fill that loophole. But what I realized immediately from my marketing background was they weren't people like that. And the marketing strategies were changing so quickly that we needed people like that. They were existing abroad, but they weren't here. So we needed people like that. And because I was already working as a brands manager, it was easy for the brands managers on my client side to say, oh, you are diversifying, how can we use your services? So even though it wasn't planned, I think all my experiences from all my other jobs also kind of made me prepared in a way. So all these years, that's what I've also been using.
I think from the moment of pivoting, that's Tammy's favorite word, is really what changed the landscape for you. We'll kind of chat about that.
Yeah, Leroy.
How are you?
I'm good.
It's interesting that I'm asking questions. Hey, now I'm inviting you to my platform on your platform. Chat to me about when did your content start becoming more than just a passion and start paying you rent?
Yeah, I think I started getting paid earlier. I don't know, but I got my first paycheck on YouTube, and it came as a surprise. Yeah, because I was doing blogging, you know, and it was hardly paying at the time, right? Because I was understudying and writing for Modern Ghana, Ghana Web, and all of that. Then I started doing the video content. So, I mean, at the time there was, I mean, 1,000 subscribers, 4,000 watch hours. Oh man, those days it wasn't like that. So I did a video about, Sarkodie and everyone else. So I did a video. I just ran a voiceover, and I went to sleep. I woke up. I came and I realized that the video has gotten 90,000 views
overnight.
And I did what? So I went to the studio session of, you know, YouTube, and I saw the green dollar sign. Like, am I making some money here? You know. So I mean, I did some research and stuff like that. You know, I went to just read a lot about the CPMs and all of that. I was like, oh, okay, so there is some money here to be made. So I just started putting it in, and then, yeah, I think the first paycheck that came was like $200. But I was, because I'm not seeing, like, you know what I mean? I couldn't believe it, you know, like, you be in your bedroom or somewhere, and then you create content, and then at the end of the month, you know, you're able to get some paycheck. So it kind of really motivated me, and that's how I just started putting in a lot more of content. But even now, I do less content. I'm really helping content creators to get monetized on platforms.
You were surprised that you got the hits. You're surprised then that YouTube would pay you. But it seems that, especially in this landscape, that it seems accidental, you know, you don't strategize. What did you think the end goal would be had you not had that interview with Sarkodie and had that virus happen? What would have happened to your content? What were you doing?
Yeah, I mean, because then you realize that you're putting everything that just comes into your mind, and then you're just putting it out there as content. The strategy was very important, because once I realized that, I mean, the views were just coming, because the views just kept coming, and I did not know how to properly, you know, align myself, you know, when to put content together, when to do content planning and all of that. So I had to self-learn. You know, I had to learn a lot. I had to watch videos from people that were making it big on, you know, YouTube and stuff like that. So even it got to a time I had to get people to assist me. You know, I had to now get a studio, you know. had to get someone to support me with the presenting and all of that. So yeah, I kind of learned the job, you know, because it was a must. It was something that I needed to do.
I think many of us learn on the job, especially in this corner of the content creation. Was yours accidental, like my other panelists? Did you wake up one morning and find yourself blowing up, or was it a bit more deliberate?
Mine, it's not like anyone else. Mine is an evolution. And I'm also not getting YouTube money yet.
You're not doing the $200 that Ray was getting.
I've never seen one before. So my YouTube, or what I use YouTube for, is to project some events done artists are doing, right? Just for the fun of it, because I know I won't get the money, right? But we started up as a traditional agency, B2, like below the line activation, getting to the malls, doing activation. But it got to a point where it wouldn't come anymore, right? And we realized we have to switch. And the role I play right now, or the position I am, I'm earning from the digital space, not as a creator, but as a strategic marketer, right? You are the one trying to draw the lines, see where you have to get in touch, what you have to do at any point in time for the brand. So that is where my monetization is. So I don't see YouTube money. I wish I do.
Well, we'll organize for you to get a masterclass on that. But for me, that's very interesting, because we're talking about the life cycle of content creation around the continent. And so many times you think it's all the traditional, you know, you have to be in front of the camera or in front of the mic, but there's such a huge ecosystem that happens in the background, where you've got now digital strategists, you've got people who are supporting teams that work around that. And it means that the stream of that economy is growing. Is the fame an issue? Is the fame more of a motivator than the money when we look at the content creation? Because we know content creators are now the new celebrities. You know, if we're looking at the cooking space, for instance, Nigella was the first lady who was a home cook, who's now, I was watching this girl with NKR and all those many things. How much of it is motivated by wanting to make a difference, wanting to make money, or just the fame? And does that corrupt the industry?
I'll take the second question first, but that corrupts the industry. I think it boils down to the interest. And I don't fault anyone who has an interest of being popular or being famous through what you're doing. I think bottom line for me is, what are you going to use that influence power for? Are you going to make people learn from you with your skills and resources? And also, what kind of impact are you trying to make? Or do you just want to make a lot of money, buy a nice car, be a beautiful girl or guy? That's really entirely up to you. For me personally, I'm very interested in creating impact through the opportunities that people like everybody else here has given me. Out of my YouTube platform, I've been able to create different businesses. So I have a light food business, I have a consultation business, and all those other things. They are through my YouTube. And now what I'm doing now and focusing on is my foundation, which is Clean Eye for Social Change. And the reason why I'm bringing that in is because I started that because of the impact from what I gained from these platforms. So I realized that, first of all, people buy food from me. So my team and I, people trust us enough to buy food from me. Not because I'm super beautiful or anything, but because they've been able to relate to me through these platforms and they trust me. So they know that whatever I'm going to give them in terms of selling food is quality ingredients, you know, promoting Ghanaian food, all connected to what I'm doing on YouTube. Now, when I work with brands, they trust me to give out the right information, because I've taken years to learn, to study, to understand what I'm doing. When I go out of the country to work with brands, it's the same thing. I'm adamant on what my purpose is, which is pushing Ghanaian and African ingredients, you know, talking about food in connection to the economy, financially. That's my focus. So yeah, the fame will come. Like if you go somewhere, someone's like, oh, Jay, hi, look Hi, Stella. Nice, right?
Excited.
But how are you going to take advantage of that new introduction, that new relationship, to say, hey, my name is Jay, or, oh, what does Mukasa chick mean? Now I have a subject to talk about. I say, oh, it means, in my language, Akan, it means kitchen, and I think I'm she. Oh, where are you from? I'm from Ghana. We start a whole conversation. So I'm happy to do that. I'm also happy to share my skills, my resources with these underprivileged women that I work with. We are building a center currently where we are inviting housewives, underprivileged women, families, and people who migrate from. They might not get the same opportunity I get or the same skill that I'm lucky to have, but they'll be able to contribute to their communities. They'll be able to take care of their children, their families, and their husbands. And all these things are all connected because of how I want to use my impact through the opportunities that YouTube and other platforms have given.
I've got so much I want to piggyback on that, but for me it's the idea that your content creation, what was an interest, became a gateway not only to financial gain, but being able to literally place yourself in spaces where you're able to make changes for not just the ordinary woman and man in Ghana, but you've been able to show us that this space, when it is a gateway and utilized properly, it's able to spring up other offshoots and, you know, other seedlings that can grow into so many different avenues, which also for me speaks to sustainability, right? Because it means that you're able, even if you decide to put the camera down one day and no longer do the content that we see online, we'd still be able to interact with you, still be able to monetize yourself and be able to speak for a greater purpose, which is very, very important, especially when we're so young in the content creation space.
And it's very interesting that you say that, because I am in the phase of my content creation where I'm literally running away from the camera.
Yeah.
I've spent like so many of my years being in front of the camera, you know, shooting for TV, for brands. And now when I see the camera, I'm literally angry.
Yeah.
Like I have come to accept and understand the space that I'm in. And I'm trying to get myself into that. But I'm saying, whilst the camera is down, what else can I do? What other influence can I do? I'm still, you know, having conversations with my other male and female content creators. I'm doing free consultation for people. In this morning, one of the culinary people just sent me a message on Instagram. She says, hey, I have this idea. I want to do this with you. And I said to her, listen, I'm so involved in so many things, I will not be committed. But what I can promise you is that I'm going to be there for you and run you through the idea and how to implement it. That's my only way of giving back. So yeah, the camera can be on all the time. The phone can be on, it's great. But when the camera is off, what happens? I love the money, you know.
The money's great.
I love the money, but to be honest, I think that being able to identify the reason why I started this, the money will come, the YouTube money will come. Because, you know, once you put content on YouTube, people will keep watching in all other countries, you will get money, da da da. But what other ways can you spread yourself, not too thin, spread yourself that you can still promote your objective of starting what you're starting. So yes, I like that you said that even when the camera is off, we should find other ways to.
And because it is a gateway, you know, Jay makes such an important point about how she's been able to look at multiple corners, start putting things in place. So it's really, and then you now started having to look at people to support you, whether it's, you know, hardware-wise or getting, you know, the platform growing, getting support in that way. We are a very young content creation community, Africa in general, but Ghana in particular. Chat to me about what we need to be doing as individual content creators, wherever we are in the spectrum of followers and subscribers, to start adding into the pot, to start benchmarking, to have an industry-based practice, so that when a new content creator comes up, they don't have to learn like we did by falling and standing up and falling again and falling to the side. What needs to be done in your opinion so that we can start making the monetization more seamless by preparing ourselves so that by the time we get into content creation, there's a real career that we can monetize.
Yeah, I mean, so that's why it's very important for community engagement, right? Like, exactly what is happening right here. I mean, we're meeting ourselves, we're seeing fellow content creators, and yesterday I was in at a masterclass that when you go for such events. I mean, sometimes it's not even about the speakers. The best person sitting next to you. I mean, you don't know who's sitting next to you, right? I mean, almost all my networking opportunities, most of them, if it did not come from some of the content that I used to create way back, it is from events that I have attended and some of the people that I network myself with. Now, as a content creator, sometimes you are so lonely, because the truth of the matter is, even though most of us here would like to be there, most of us here are also, most of the time.
Yeah.
I mean, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's just feel that maybe you see them partying and clubbing and stuff like that, but most content creators spend most of their time at home.
Editing, posting, cleaning up, making sure the content is there.
Yes, you know what I mean? So it is very important that we join communities. There are lots of communities out there. You know, for example, I mean, our platform, we try to bring content creators together. It used to be the YouTube Creators Festival, but now we're making the Creators Festival because we want to make sure that we get into the whole ecosystem. People are doing a lot on TikTok. People are doing a lot on Instagram Reels. And I have partnered a brand in Nigeria where now we're helping creators to monetize their Facebook videos. And I was shocked that most of my fellow content creators didn't even know that Facebook monetizes videos.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And yeah, I was utterly shocked. So I started working with this company and I started approaching some of my friends. Okay, look, we want to help you monetize your Facebook. Like with what Facebook pays. So we started getting them to start creating content on Facebook. So I mean like the popular ones, right? And then now they started the content that they're posting on YouTube, they started posting them on Facebook. So they're not even creating different content, but then they're just putting it there. Now they realize that now they're making more money off some of these content than on YouTube. Because now there's a lot of competition amongst the platforms. And I mean, we are here. I mean, they are the big fishes, right? But what we're doing, we are creators. What we can do is to keep creating. And you realize that there are different audiences all together. Because you go on TikTok and you realize that the audience that are on TikTok is not really the same as the Instagrammers. And then you come on Facebook and there's a little bit of the older generation, millennials. So yeah. To be able to learn here, in our space, you really need to join a lot of communities and you need to network among other fellow content creators.
And community and even across the diaspora.
Yeah.
Is possibly the gap you want to take that on?
Yes. So I know we know the popular phrase that says, just do it, Nikes. It sounds cliche, but that's the honest truth. And I'm saying this to you because personally, that also applies to me. Just do it, but with a plan. When I started, it was just do it. Now I know that you need a plan. You know, I realized that even for me, it's like we are all looking for the best camera, the best sound, the best of all the equipment. And then we start saying, we start saying, internet here, cheaper. Wait, me after iPhone, no, it's here, kitty. You know, it's like there's this comparison. Trust me, go to any of your favorite YouTuber and go down to when they started. You will see the difference.
Yeah.
Like, they look like they're still in a cloud. And then all of us, like, you go up and it's so clear, it's so nice, it's great. But we are always waiting for the right equipment, the right people to start. For me, I also have a production background and I've fought with that so many years. It's like, I'm looking for a sound guy, an editor, this and that. But we will not get it now. We don't have a creative economy in Ghana right now that's helping creators get there. But I think that's very important that we start in our own way. So that if people are interested in this economy and it comes to a point where they can say, oh, come to this studio and come and shoot, you'll be prepared. Once you get there, you know how you started, you know where you're going, you know what you want to do. You're not going to go there as a naive person. And also, please, like, ask questions. I think that sometimes as creators, we are in our heads. Like, you see him creating stuff, and you think, oh my God, this is awesome. You can ask him, hey, app do you use to edit your this? What app do you, where do you shoot? If the person is willing to share, it's always the best form of learning. We see that YouTube is a university, it's great. But sometimes, demographically, like if you look at an American YouTuber, demographically, it's not the same.
Worlds apart.
Worlds apart. Like so many things work against us. It's not the same at all. I remember when the Global Citizen came to Ghana recently, YouTube brought some creators together. Stella, you were there, right? YouTube brought some creators together. So we had Ghana, we had Nigeria, Kenya, South Africa, and you know, we're all introducing ourselves and talking about how. Whilst we're having the conversation, it struck me, like, even our ages, like looking at the content creators from South Africa and looking at us from Ghana and Nigeria, it was like a millennial against a Gen Z. It was so wild. Like even talking about how much they were earning and you know the tools available to them. And I remember with Imaya asking them that there's so many opportunities which are not being available to us in Ghana. Like currently YouTube Shorts is, you know, helping people learn about Shorts and what. There is no Ghana. It's just Nigeria, Kenya, and South Africa. So we have so much working against us right now, but the only thing we can do is to kind of stop comparing and looking at, you know, all these people have worked so hard to be able to buy a Canon or whatever camera it is, and start using what we have and start asking for help to say, hey, I know you have a camera. He's a strategist. I know you have a camera. You don't shoot. Can I come and shoot with your camera? Edit for me. If I can't pay you now, when I get the money, I will give you this, that.
You know, I was about to chat about sustainability and how you sustain yourself when you don't have the resources, because cameras are really expensive. I can only speak in Rand, but for a mid-size normal camera, you can charge anything up to 50,000 Rand, right? Which is ridiculous. And I was going to come to you, Brad, and said, let's chat about how from the community of content creators, specifically around people who aren't necessarily in front of the camera, the strategists, the content creators, the content planners, the campaign managers, those kind of people, what can we do to start working on how we sustain the industry that is building itself and growing? Because what I'm hearing from my fellow panelists here is that everything they're doing is sort of, again, falling forward. You know, industry best practice hasn't been established here. We're doing it as we go along. We're asking questions, but, you know, it's a young economy, you know, and you might be one of the only four strategists in the whole of Ghana, because it's a new job to us. Where if I speak for South Africa, for instance, we've got social media managers, campaign managers, people who just do content planning for companies only. That's their only job. So what do we do sustainably? What do we need to do so that even the jobs outside of the camera can be sustained and grow this industry? Because you see, we are on the 360 of the industry, you know, front of camera, behind camera, side of camera.
Well, good. I would want to touch on something. Creators. Who are creators? Anyone here is a creator. Anyone, my mom is a creator. Creator is God. God is the creator. Like, just get this and it would help you, because why is God one of the greatest people in the world, or is the greatest in the world? Because he created something. It's not religious. It's just basic logic. He creates. We all create, right? So basically, why am I saying this? We undervalue what we do. You work with a company, you're a graphic designer. You are creating something. Anything we are over here, someone created the outfit, someone created the banner behind me, but we don't seem to own it. We are not proud of what we are doing, right? And collaboration is key. Now, how do we sustain? We need to know where we fall short. Let me tell you a very short story. That was last 2 weeks or so. The Swiss Embassy needed some influencers in the female-led conversation, or who are talking about female-led, even climate change. We are not getting any of them. We are looking at, I don't know what we are looking at, but we are focusing on entertainment, focusing on some, sorry to say, so much bigger stuff, whilst they are funding for climate change. So what am I trying to say? We need to do more research. we need to understand. Maybe you don't need anything to understand research. Climate change. I don't need anything to understand marketing. In fact, I didn't do marketing. I've been practicing marketing since almost 10 years now. Right? I did philosophy and psychology. I don't know where the certificate is. Do you understand?
I don't know what degree is.
So what am I trying to say? What you can do and research is the only sustainable goal or plan you need to have. Climate change, let me pick for instance. There are so many climate change conversations ongoing.